Good morning, everyone. My name is Kellen. I am going to be doing some electro-etching for us today with this, the Northwest Blacksmith Association digital demo series. I don't even know what number we're on. So what are we on, Claire?
We're on 34.
I want to introduce everybody to Kenny O'Loughlin. Kenny's going to be our host today.
O'Loughlin.
There you go.
So I'm going to start by showing you what an etch looks like. I recently did a couple of awards and had to put together a plate. See if I can't see this right. So this is an etched plate that goes on it. This one's on brass. I have so far had a lot of success etching brass and copper and steel. I haven't really tried much outside of that, and I've only done mild steel. This process is not like an etch that you would use to bring out Damascus lines in a blade. This is like purely for adding images or text to steel for like a plate. I just don't think that, you know, if you're looking to like etch in a maker's mark on something, this is not really the way. Here's an etch I made a long time ago for a project that kind of then got abandoned, so I never really finished cleaning this up. But I just took a picture of this building that had some importance for a person and just turned that into a black and white image and got it to etch on here. So there's a few different ways to etch. I started by using acid. And the big thing with etching is that you are trying to remove material in a controlled fashion, whether it's with electro-etching or burning it out with acid. So you need to protect the metals around it, and that's called a resist. And so the resist that I use is a PNP transfer paper, and we'll get into all that. But you need to be able to protect everything really well. And then I'm using electro etching. And the process with electro etching, I'm going to draw kind of like a diagram here, is you have a tub of some variety, and then you need a medium in it. Right? Here's my medium. It needs to be salt based. And you can use just straight salt water with this if it's really heavy, like a brine. But it's not quite as effective as using a metallic salt. Copper sulfate is kind of the salt to use for almost all this stuff. It is available at home and garden stores, feed stores, seed places. It comes in these blue, bright blue crystals. You need to mix it in with water. I just use a 5-gallon bucket. Depending on the size of your etch, you don't need a lot of volume. My things are often larger, so I use a bucket, and I've done bigger things that I've had to use its own kind of Tupperware containers. But you need the salt bath. And so I started with copper sulfate and was really liking it and was doing some more research on it. And I found a product called Ready Etch. And I can actually, let me just tell you guys the website, because I got this bucket of it here. Ready Etch is, it's coppersulfatecrystals.com. is where you can get that from. I bought a whole 5-gallon bucket of it about 10 years ago, and I have been using it ever since. It lasts quite a bit. So one of the things that led me to electro-etching from using acids was that every time you would etch with acid, your acid becomes weaker, and then you run it, you start to collect this slurry, the sludge that comes out of the bottom of the acid. It's like a waste product and it's gross. And I wasn't sure how to dispose of it. And so I was just collecting it and then finally going to our local dump and saying like, what do I do with this? And they had me put it in this like toxic chemicals vat that they collect all the crap with. And then I discovered this product, and copper sulfate's really benign. It's used in many different agricultural type products. I believe it'll like make your grass greener, but don't quote me on it. I wouldn't put it on your grass without doing some of your own research. But with the Electro-etch, it kind of maintains its strength throughout. And so to etch something with acid, the first time you etch it, it might take 20 minutes to etch the thing you are trying to do. And then if you did the exact same part again, it might be 30 minutes the next time. And then five times later, to get the same depth of an etch, it might be an hour and a half that it has to be in there. So it progressively gets weaker. And this, using an Electro-etch, you can really have repeatable results. If it takes 15 minutes, it's probably going to take 15 minutes almost indefinitely. This solution does sort of wear out over time. I have swapped my solution a few times, or brightened it up rather by just like adding more crystal to it. But that's kind of your medium that you need. It's some sort of like a salt bath, and I recommend copper sulfate. Then you have the piece you're going to etch. You need to suspend it in this bath, and that is called an anode. The anode is going to have a positive lead clipped to it, and then you need another piece of similar metal. I cannot stress how important it is to have a similar metal. And if I'm writing upside down, C goes the other way. Does that look like a C? No, that's a C for me. Upside down's hard, guys. C. This is a cathode. And that is going to have a negative lead on it. So what Electro-etching essentially is doing is plating in reverse. If this was a plating solution, you can use the same bath, although I believe there are some acids that are better for this. You would take your anode, which is where all the little molecules, they're gonna travel this way, and then plate onto here. Does that make sense? So as you're running the current through, the electricity is traveling through this medium and it's pulling pieces of metal off of this and then plating them onto this one. So coming from your anode to your cathode. And so in the plating industry, this would be like a sack of like ball bearings or something, and like a metal sack, this would be a sacrificial metal. This would be the piece that is super clean and you're wanting to plate in copper, you're wanting to plate it in brass or whatever you're trying to plate with. And so with the etching, we're doing the same thing, except we want to control the removal of all this. So we have resisted everything, we've covered it and protected it, except for the image that we want to preserve. And so the only spot that it can pull those molecules off of to plate onto the cathode are only the spots that we've left alone that are not protected. So it's really important to protect all your stuff. So this is like a really quick and brief kind of synopsis of how the Electro-etch process works. And some of it takes some time. We're gonna etch two pieces today. I prepped this one already in copper. I made a little NWBA tag. I've got another one that we're gonna show kind of how this transfer process works, how to protect everything. We're gonna do that one out of steel, which is cold rolled. Electro-etching does not like to run through scale. It is like, scale is way too hard. So you can use things that have been scaled, but you have to bring it down to like shiny bare metal to be able to pull these molecules off of it. I've tried through hot rolled sheet, and it's just the results are pretty poor. So, but copper takes significantly longer than steel. I bet you we have to etch this copper one for 35 to 40 minutes, somewhere in that range. And this one is going to be probably closer to 10. And so for time's sake, I'm going to skip a bunch of steps because I already have this prepped. We're going to get it into the salt bath and get it going so that it can be etching while I'm working on the rest of the prep stuff. So let's take a look over here. So
Liz mentions it's like electroplating, but in reverse.
Pretty much. I like to kind of think of it as controlled electroplating, where you're only, you know, you're really trying to control what your sacrificial piece is, because your sacrificial piece is actually the one that you care about. Whereas in plating, that would all just be like sacrificial metals that would just turn into molecules to be plated. So let me show you what the inside of this looks. So this is a slightly used batch. It's got this really blue to it. If it was really fresh, it is like three times that vibrant. It's like bright Kool-Aid blue. That's still a good spot. So you want to stir it up, especially if you haven't used it in a while. I just did some etching yesterday, so this one's pretty fresh. But if I hadn't used this in a while, there'd be crystals formed everywhere, and it'd be on the bottom, and you can feel them while you're stirring. It is like, there's a lot going on there. You really want to make sure you break all that up. So since we're going to etch a piece of copper, we need to use a like piece of metal. This is a piece of brass that I have that I've been using as an electroplate. And you can kind of see what side I usually have facing, because this is where the rule of the plating is going to happen. I got a piece of copper in there would work. I used a piece of brass. Because brass has so much copper in it, it's still going to work as being a very similar metal. So this part's always a little tricky, and I filled my bucket up maybe a little too much, actually. And over the years, have used these clamps for things and lost my rubber grips. If you have rubber grips on the end, it's really the best way to have it. So you got to submerge the first one, and it's all low voltage stuff, and I have by accident, you know, touched these things while electricity is going through it. Things have been fine. It won't really shock you, but it's really good practice just to keep your fingers out of the electricity, which is why I use wood. I use a plastic bucket, alligator clips for my positive and negative. I keep my positive with a red lead, and I'm using white for my negative, which is different than a ground. This is a negative, not a ground. So let me show you here, get a little closer view. I'm just hooking that alligator clip right on the edge of this metal. I'm trying to keep the clip itself out of the water, but just get it clipped. So you always kind of need to leave a little bit out and above. Let's just get closer so you guys can see. And then I'm going to do the same thing with the one that we're etching.
Peter Clark has noticed that Harold the Rat is steadfast, waiting for instruction.
Yeah, I told him I was doing an NWBA thing, and he wouldn't leave me alone, so I told him. Okay, so the next part, and this is important, I think. If you want an even etch, make sure I get a good hand on my phone. I don't know if you can see this. These things are parallel to each other. You want to get them about as close as they can be. Right now, I'm limited by the clamp is what is keeping them apart. The closer they are, the less distance that that has to travel. And I like to face the images towards each other. And once this is going, I'll draw a little picture. I'll kind of show you how some of this works and what I've learned from trial and error. Let me see if this can turn on yet. Okay. I forgot to charge my iPad. I was going to use it as a timer. I'm going to ditch this. So I need to ask for a little audience participation. If somebody has a phone or something that they can set a timer for me, that would be awesome. Once we get this started, I need to have a 15-minute time countdown, and then you guys got to let me know when my 15 minutes is up. Somebody on that?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to turn this rectifier on. So this is a DC power supply. I ordered it online. I think this one cost me like $130. This has got a, I believe it's 30 volt, 6 amp unit. You can use a number of different things. I've done this with like a car charger before. You need a DC power supply. Okay. You can do this with a 9-volt battery if your etch is small enough and you think you can just get it done. But it's all about the amperage. So I'm going to turn this thing up. And of course, my amperage is super low today. Why are you so low? So one of the things that I've noticed, and I dealt with this yesterday, is that the alligator clips that I'm using were plated in copper, but they're steel underneath. And I got them in the solution at one point, and so it ate the copper away. And then the steel gets rusty, and so my contact leads have some rust between them. So I'm just taking a file to the tip of this right now. I did this yesterday, but it kind of flash rusted overnight.
So I guess your timing would be a lot different if you're using a battery charger.
Yeah. And so a lot of it is going to be based off of how many amps you're putting into the thing. I have found that the perfect amperage number, at least for me and a lot of the work that I've been using for etching, is about 2.5 amps. It goes quick enough, but it's not crazy aggressive. And I'll show you guys why in a second. You don't want it to be crazy aggressive, but you do need it to have some speed to it. Okay, let's try this again. Your amperage is also going to be controlled by how much surface area is able to go through and the material. And so this is really low. I'm running at about 1/8 of an amp here, and I really wish that was higher. I'd love to have about 2.5 amps. And sometimes I just can't quite tell what the difference is, but it's going to be working because as long as this isn't reading zero, some molecules are going through. So we can start a timer on that and we'll check in 15 minutes. So when etching, let's just do a cross section here. Let's say this is the piece of metal and you have resisted and resisted. And this is the line that you're trying to get here. Is that clear enough? And so what you want it to do is come straight down and etch in a little bit of a channel, right? It's like a cross section of that. Well, what happens is as it is going through, once it makes it past the resist, there's nothing to keep it from spreading. And so it can start to undercut your resist if it's in there for too long or you have too much amperage running through. That process gets faster. And so not so important if you're doing something that is just like cool shapes. Much more important if you're doing something like this trophy and you have some smaller letters, you know, that word central will turn into like real quick if you let it undercut and it spends too much time in there. But you don't really need to go crazy deep with all these etches because really you're just trying to convey this font that's coming across or this picture. And so it doesn't need to be crazy deep.
So when you do the large letter and the small letter, do you do it at the same time or?
Oh yeah, I do everything at the same time.
So it's not going to take any longer for the large letter as the little letter?
No, it all takes about the same time, but okay. You kind of have a time limit on the far end. And I've learned for this PNP paper, it's about 40 to 45 minutes of being in that solution with things happening before it starts to fail. And then you get, here I can even show you on that same piece, you start to get this stuff, these little like blemishes that are happening. I ran this one for 45 minutes and I should have pulled it out closer to 40. Because the last time I had it out at 30 minutes. And there was hardly any of this little background kind of antiquing, which is a look that I like for a lot of things, but I shouldn't have left it in there so long because some of these got a little deeper, harder to buff out. I had to just kind of let them go. Some of which can be avoided by how well you clean your metal before you put the resist on. But before I get, yep.
You will be discussing the resists later.
Oh yeah, no, we're gonna fully resist the piece while this one's cooking. And I would just show here, I don't know if you guys can see, it mellowed itself out. We're up to 2.5 amps and slowly climbing. I'm gonna keep an eye on that. And if it looks like it's getting above like 2.75 amps, I will tune it down. And this rectifier, here, I'll just do it right now. This rectifier is really cool. It's got a coarse adjustment, so I can really move amps around coarsely, and I just kind of maxed it out since it wasn't working. So I can do big adjustments. Nope. Sometimes you go messing with it, and then it loses its amperage. Well, we're down to less than an amp now. But climbing back up. Okay, so this is one of the things, and this might be one of the last drawings I make. Here's the top view of this bucket. I've got two pieces. Let's call this one my cathode, and this one my anode. And so pieces are going straight across into here, but they're not just going straight across. They're coming out and they're going like this as well. There's like a circular motion that happens with electricity in these fluids. And so this is the straightest point across. And, you know, if our etch is this wide, more material is going to get removed in the middle of it because it's got a really direct current that runs across here. And less on the outside. And this is not always visible unless you're doing something that's like, you have a larger swath that you're trying to etch. So if that's happening with one of my etches, and it has happened before where I've got a lot of text, it's a bigger plate. You guys saw that beer machine that Hunter and I made. It had a lot of etch plates on it. And some of them were quite large and had a lot of text. And I was seeing that my text in the middle was etching rather deeply and the text on the outside was not. And so then what I did is I flipped this piece around, right? So then I've flipped it around. And so now my etch is on this side of it and using the circular motion, it's pulling it like this. And since it's doing this, it's the edge pieces that are the path of least resistance, not the middle. And so that's kind of like advanced etching 101. You can flip it and kind of balance your etch out if it needs it. Most of them would never need it, but We're going to talk a little bit about how I go about my resist. So I use this product. It is called Press and Peel Blue, P&P Blue. This is available at this company right here, Technics, T-E-C-H-N-I-K-S. I believe it's technics.com. If you put in P&P Blue, it'll come up. But Technics is the place I buy it from. They're meant for making circuit boards, is kind of how it all started. These sheets are plastic. They're a type of plastic. One side is very high gloss. The other side is a matte. And so this works on laser printers and photocopiers. And you need to print it onto this matte side. And so you're using the toner that comes from the printer or from the photocopier as your resist. Not all printers are created equal. If this is something you're gonna get into, I recommend either, you know, trying your own if you have a laser at home. I bought an old like office copy machine from a plumbing company that was going out of business years ago. So I used it all for myself. I'm kind of real low on toner. The machine's a little dirty, so it doesn't always print super evenly. But I kind of like it because I like it when my plates look antique. And that is what you get if it's dirty. So I'm going to start with this piece. And you want to cut it down to size, but it doesn't need to be, I wouldn't get too close to the unit because having this extra resist that's built in is worth having. So this is going to be my resist. And you can notice here that I have printed the negative because I want to etch the positive. So everywhere that there is not black is what's going to etch. Everywhere that the blue is showing through is going to be where the etch comes from. And this is backwards. You need a mirror image of whatever you're doing because when you apply it, you're going to do it face down, burnish it on there, and then it flips all the letters. So something to keep in mind. Some images, it doesn't matter. And while we're just talking about P&P paper, if you're into repoussé, it is so worth doing. This is P&P. I've put this image on here. This was like one of my next repoussé projects I was gonna make. This stuff will withstand some heat. I could heat this whole thing up and anneal it, and I would still be able to see almost this entire image for at least a time or two. A lot of the etching that I have done, or a lot of the repoussé I have done in the past, like this one started off as those P&P, and it really let me trace those lines with a chisel to get this one started. It's just a lot easier than trying to like transfer a drawing over by hand or make sure that that is working. Okay. So to put this on here, we're going to do two things. I got to clean this with some acetone. I already buffed it off yesterday. I might even give it a quick little go. I'm using a Scotch-Brite pad on the end of an angle grinder. This could be done with just high grit sandpaper to get it clean. Quick second off camera. Okay, let me grab some acetone. Make sure we get all the dirt off of there. Well, we'll just get this cleaned. And then we'll check on the other etch before we burnish this on. So I'm just using some acetone and I'm trying to get just whatever dirt might be on here off, dirt and oil. Because anywhere that there is dirt and oil, especially dust, if it gets between the layers, it won't bond. So I'll usually kind of give it a wipe if I see anything. And then I'll give it a little blow.
Can you talk about the printer one more time?
Sure. So it needs toner, which is available on like any copy machine. or a laser jet.
Okay.
And so, but any other printer, it's like not really going to work as a resist. And so for years, before I bought my own copy machine, I was going down to there was like a local print shop in town that I'd become friends with the guy. He was letting me run these things. This PNP blue, this blue paper, depending on how much you order, if you only get 20 sheets, they're about $2 a sheet after shipping. If you get 100 sheets, they're about $1 a sheet. And so, you know, they're not the cheapest things in the world. So you kind of want to do it correctly every time you do it. The sheets themselves will withstand, I think, up to like 500 or 600 degrees of temperature before they start to fail. And some copy places are like, I am not putting that piece of plastic through my like $2,000 printer because they think it's going to fail. And so I usually will bring with me the packet that it comes in, because it shows right here for laser printers and photocopiers. And then I tell them, you know, I'm heating this thing up to 400 plus degrees. It's not going to fail in your machine. Some are into it, some are not. I've kind of had to make relationships. What's that?
1 minute left.
Okay. You got to work on those relationships. If you don't have those printers, find somebody who's going to trust that you can put this thing through, and then be able to print it off. If we're at 30 seconds, you can just kind of stop that, but get ready to start it again. We're just going to turn this off and then let me get a little closer and see if maybe we're going to be able to see it. Oh, I usually do this part up top. So I've turned the rectifier off. So there's no more electricity coming through here. We're leaving the cathode alone. We only want the anode. You can see all this white that's happening on it. That is it working. And so I'm going to really lightly agitate just the zones that I'm etching. Too much agitation will start to fail the rest of your resist.
That distilled water, regular water?
Tap water. So while I got this piece out, I'm going to show you a couple things. So one, you can see that my printer, it's because my photocopier is dirty and old. This image should not have had anything inside these letters, but it kind of printed it. And I really liked it because it almost looked like a shadow that was like fading from one side to the other. So I just went with it. The other one has that as well. Who will be able to see it? But you can see that it is like starting to etch. And so one of the other tools that I keep on hand is a toothpick. And that is just to feel the curb. It's like a tactile thing. I can feel that I'm down there. It is not a very deep etch at all, but it is. I could stop this process right now and have a little bit of cleaning and it would come through as being an anvil and a hammer and saying NWBA. I like them to be deeper than this though. So I'm going to rig it back up and put it back in. And this is based off of my experience with my rectifier and this solution and knowing about how many square inches I'm etching right now. And so I'm guessing this is gonna be about a 40 minute etch altogether. It's a good idea to set timers and continue to check on these things as you go, especially as you're learning. 10 minutes, every 10 minutes is not a bad thing to do. And if you're doing it in steel is significantly faster. So I would even say almost every 5 minutes with steel. Let's start that timer again for another 15. Now we're gonna go to the burnishing. Hot plate. I've cooked a lot of bacon on this plate. And then I started getting into etching and I stopped cooking bacon on it and it's just coming to the shop. This one goes up to 400 degrees. I max it out. I am assuming that that is relatively close. You can start burnishing this stuff at about 350 degrees. You don't need a hot plate necessarily. You could do it with a torch. If you get it over hot, it does start to like mess with the plastics, and with the air pressures of torches, it's hard. I have done larger pieces by floating them above a forge that wouldn't fit on here. But what we're gonna do is let this hot plate get hot before we put this on. And I like to, one, pick a piece that's bigger. After the etch is done is when I remove material to bring down to the etch plate that I have or that I want to have remaining. And so one of the things that I did here is I drew a circle around this one. The other one has a square around it. And I'm not planning on leaving that circle. I'm going to cut right to that circle and use it as a control line to make it be this size. So that's going to take just a minute to get hot. For the plates that I made for those awards, I'll put little notches in the corner, little half inch by half inch right angle pieces, knowing where I need to bring it back to. So I'm only etching a little bit in the corner, but it gives me control lines. So I'm not having to measure off the font to figure out how far up. Adding those control lines has been something that's taken me a while to learn, but putting them in the etch before you do it, so you know how big you want the thing to end up, is going to be more successful than etching a plate and then trying to figure out what a rectangle looks like around words that have no straight lines or anything other than just the fonts. Almost warm. So when we get it down here, we're gonna let it heat up and then we have to burnish it on there. You can use a spoon or some kind of a softer edged thing. That's how I started doing this stuff. And then I found one of these printing speedball rollers and thought it was gonna be the greatest thing that ever happened, and it worked, but it's so wide, it was like not working great. And then I went to the skate shop and I got those guys to give me an old flat skateboard wheel, chucked it up in a bolt, bent the bolt, and this has been like my go-to for my etching. It's nice to have a little out the backside so I have pressure on both sides. I'm not just trying to like control it with one hand. Probably should have turned this hot plate on a minute or two earlier. But I'm gonna have two plates here at the end. One's gonna be square and out of copper, and the other one's gonna be round and out of steel. And if anybody's interested in them, I'd be happy to auction these things off in this group. All the proceeds go to the NWBA. So right now this thing could move. It's not getting, the heat's not high enough yet. So I'm just using this to kind of pin it down until I can see, see, it just slid with me. I'm gonna get this a little closer. So once it starts to kick, you can really tell because the color starts to change. And this is where it's really nice to, I think, have an oversized plate that you're etching and then you're cutting down. If this plate was exactly the size of the etch, one, I wouldn't have anywhere I could hook to get it into the bath. And two, all it would take is me bumping this just before the ink kicked, and it might move and then no longer be centered in the plate like it just did there. And so I recommend putting the etch on the plate, dropping it down all at the same time. versus putting this plate down and having my metal get hot and then trying to place this on hot metal. But I can start to see that there's a little bit of color difference that's happening in the middle. And so it's going to want to create some air pockets. So I'm kind of coming from the inside and rolling out. And then once it's stuck, then I'll start kind of going all the way across. And so I don't know if the camera is going to be able to pick this up, but you can see there's these little like air bubbles.
Yeah, you could see
them happening. Yeah. Those air bubbles are often little tiny pieces of dust that I didn't catch and get out of here. So you can really mitigate all of them if you take a lot of control. Some of them are just air bubbles. And you can, if you do it early enough, you can drag them out of your zone. And another thing you can do, which I wasn't fully prepared for here, let's see if I got, having some razor blades on hand is usually worthwhile with this, because I know that in the letters is where I'm etching. And so it doesn't matter if I like mar that up a little bit. And so if I had a big bubble, I can cut through the plastic and then squeeze that bubble out of there. And so, you know, I'm not going to take a ton of time trying to get all these little bubbles out of here, because it's going to make this thing look antique. And I really like that look with this. So then you got to cool it off. And I only got buckets out here. And you can tell, can you guys see how different the color changed, how dark it got?
Yes, it's obvious.
Okay, that's kind of when you know it's done. And then I will quench it off. All I have is buckets out here. If I was inside, I would have used a faucet and I would have poured the water directly on the plastic, because it would cool the plastic first before the metal starts to cool, which would make sure all that ink got released. Doing it this way kind of cools everything at the same time. And I just think that the resist stays on there a little better. Okay, so then you just find the edge and pull it off. And here we've got a really good beginning to a resisted piece. You can see where some of these air bubbles were, where it's not totally solid, but the whole shape's there, the font looks good. I always try to focus on the areas that have font in them or where the lines are. And out here in the fields, if there's bubbles, I'm less concerned because we can add more resist afterwards. And then I think you get these cool like transparent sheets that have your image on them. So I'm gonna dry this whole thing off.
So if you have any thoughts on, Bryson was curious about using clear nail polish as a resist.
Yeah, so I do have some thoughts on all the nail polishes. I've used a bunch of different types of resist, and I have found the very best one of all of them is Bic Whiteout. The green one, extra coverage, regular whiteout will not hold up to acid or this bath, but something about their extra coverage one really sticks, and it's great. And so one of the main things I use for resist is just packing tape. And I will always start on my perimeter. and I purposefully hang it off the edges quite a bit. And then I work on that inside edge and make sure that it is sealed. And so I've got lots of tape hanging off in both directions because that lets me put it on the backside too. And then it's tape sticking to tape and not trying to fold around a corner. I think it keeps the seams a whole lot tighter. I'll do the whole front. I'm always really kind of concerned on where the tape meets the tape. Now for this one, I'm cutting it down to this circle. So I'm not actually, don't need to be that concerned with how well all the metal is protected. But I think it's good practice to try to keep it all as clean as you can. And then once I get it down, I will flip the whole thing.
You charge by the hour on this stuff?
It is so hard to charge for etches because it's so expensive.
Yeah,
there's so much labor that goes into it. I've kind of learned that I'm doing it often because I really like the way that it looks. If I was trying to like bit it correctly, an etch this size, I would probably charge $75 for, if not more. And I wouldn't be making shop rate during that. I would be like, just kind of doing it. I don't do a lot of etching for things. I will etch projects that I'm making, like these trophies, because it's all about the trophy for me, but I don't want to go get a laser etched plate to finish it off. I'd rather have done the whole thing in house. And so, you know, they get a better deal on the etching than if they just called me for plates.
Kellen, you're coming up at 1 minute left on the timer.
Oh, perfect timing. Thank you, Claire. Okay, hold on. Let me grab a pair of scissors. Okay, so got this whole perimeter done. It's tape pinched to tape, right? So like that's like a really good seal running all the way through. And as long as I don't dip the total top in there, it shouldn't really be able to get in there. And I'll just cut it down a little bit to make it a little more manageable so there's a little less like floppiness going on. And so, you know what? I'm just gonna do all this whiteout. If we go over a little 15 minutes, it's not a hard and fast rule to be like at 15 minutes. So
your timer's over.
Okay. Well, as soon as I get done whiteouting it, I'll go deal with all that. So now I'm going to come through and I'm going to find the like most egregious of those spots. And I am adding a little bit of whiteout.
I'm coming up on a lob.
What's that?
Since you've taped it all up, where do your alligator clips? Does it matter?
I left the top untaped. There's about an inch of untaped top.
Thanks.
There's been other projects that I've done. Like if you've been to the Mentoring Center and have hung out around that big fire pit we got there that has the dragons and actually like looked at the tables, those tables are etched to look like cracked earth. And they're quite large. I want to say it's like 3/8 inch thick by 16 inches across or something like that. And with that one, I had to get its own bath. It would not fit in a bucket. I think I got all the major spots. We're gonna let that dry. It wouldn't fit in a bath. So I had to have a Tupperware container that was quite larger than this and take the whole piece and float it at the bottom. Or then I took the cathode and laid it across the bottom and welded on a stick that came up that I could put a clip to. And then I put little wooden blocks down there. I think I'd use wood, maybe use plastic. And then set the other one on top of it. So they were floating face to face, but down in a bath. And I'd had to weld a peg to it as well. And I resisted the whole back of it, brought wide out up the peg so that I could get clips on it. And you can do the same thing with like coppers and whatnot with solder. Okay, we're gonna turn rectifier off. Pull the alligator clip.
Did you ever mention the ratio of copper sulfate to water?
No, I didn't. I think it might be written on there, but I'm not positive. It's like a lot.
Make it thick, yeah.
Yeah, I want to say like, if you go to the home and garden store, it probably comes in like a 1 pound bag. And I would say like 1 pound bag for 5 gallons of water is about as light as you would want to make it. You could go heavier than that. It's not going to hurt anything to have a really, really thick briny solution.
Thank you.
Okay. So, yep, I can feel it. It's definitely getting thicker. It's gone down there quite a bit. Okay, this is a good time to look at this. Let's see if we can get zoomed in enough. Undercutting. There was a little center to the A there. Come on, focus. There was a center to the A there. It's gone. The B, these little deals, almost gone. Let's take a look at the one we just did. This was the exact same picture. You can see B much more, A hardly anything there, but there was a thing there. And so that is what happened with undercutting. There was resist that was there, but as it went down, it let it go sideways. And so it undercut those things. I'm looking at this, there's a curb. And there's still just a little bit that's left on here that I kind of like. I think we could go deeper if we wanted to. But since this other one's ready, I might call this one quits and start doing a cleaning process on this versus trying to put it back in there. Because going back in there now is when like some of this resist will start to fail. And you can see some of these spots that are next to where I put white out that are maybe starting to have little pinholes that are in them. And that's gonna turn into what is an antique look, which I like, but it's not quite for everybody. So we're gonna set this in here. Whiteout feels dry. I'm kind of checking it and it all feels good. Turn your hot plate off when you're done or you'll touch it later and it'll burn you. Okay, so I got to do a full swap on this unit. because I have a piece of brass that's in here, is my cathode, and a piece of brass is not going to act the same for a piece of steel as a piece of steel. So steel's where it gets weird a little bit. One, it's not the greatest for your bath. Steel is going to kill that bath faster than anything else. If you are sticking purely to copper, purely to brass, you could use that bath over and over and over and over again for so long. You start doing steel in it, it starts to degrade the bath. And that is because you can't plate with steel. Steel hits the saltwater solution, it comes off in little pieces and it just flash rusts in there and then clumps to this because there's like a magnetic pole. But as soon as you turn the machine off, it either trickles to the bottom and then you just have a bunch of like steel dust that's in this, or it sticks to this and it's just this sludge that is not plated. It's just like stuck to it. And so it is a little different. Okay, I'm going to start by, see, check that out. I put that in shiny, right? It was shiny when I just dropped it in there, and now it is covered with a bright layer of rust. It barely spent any time in there.
So you have two pieces of steel in there.
I got two pieces of steel in here now. I got one is my cathode and one is my anode. The anode's the one that we just put all that resist on. The cathode is just another piece of steel. We're gonna turn this back on and see, this is like way more conductive because it really wants to happen. Are you guys able to read those numbers? Are they too far away?
Yeah.
This thing was barely pulling two amps, and now we've jumped up to 4.5. So I got to turn this thing down. And it's not about the voltage. The voltage is so small. It's all about the amps. And so I'm going to bring this thing in, dial it in right at 2.5. And I bet you with this one, it just sits there. Can we start a timer for 5 minutes? We are going to now come back and look at the one that we made with copper. So I'm going to brush off the front a little bit, just try to get some of this gunk off of it. Find a corner, start to peel the tape. I found not all packaging tape is created equal. Scotch is really good. Scotch kind of releases from all this stuff. Some other brands of tape, you go to pull this off and it is just shredding everywhere and it's leaving tape behind and it makes the cleanup process quite lengthy. And I don't leave my, pretty much everything that's in this etch kit, minus like my little set of tongs, does not live in my shop. I take it and I store it in my garage or in the house. Because all this stuff, you don't want to get it dusty. You don't want steel dust getting in your rectifier. You don't want the bucket getting like knocked over. You don't want your tape freezing. You don't want the whiteout to freeze. And so it's a good idea to kind of keep all these products somewhat protected. Okay, so there it is without the tape on. We got this, the light's really reflective here. So I want to cut this thing back down to this line, and I'm going to do all that cutting before I do anything else. And you can see, let's see if I can't get it to flash just right. You see how the inside of this has got all this pitting? So that is really like, you can see exactly how it's pulling kind of molecules out, and it's following in paths of least resistance, where everywhere there's a pit was like a really a hot spot where like it was pulling that material out of there. And then other spots, it's a little smoother, like right here. And I don't know if it's the composition of the metal or just kind of where it surfaces, or maybe the plate that was on the other side was a little less clean or couldn't kind of take it as well. But it really adds a lot of texture to these things.
So it's important to clean the cathode good.
It doesn't need to be perfectly clean, but I have had better luck when it is clean-ish. You know what? I'm going to move this. Okay, I'm going to turn the phase converter on.
30 seconds left.
All right. So I'm not trying to cut right to the line right away.
I guess using TID snips would really screw that up.
Well, maybe this one, because it's so thick. It'd be a hard cut on TID snips, but a Beverly shear would do it. It kind of rolls it a little bit, which makes it, you have to have a straightening process. Okay, my camera got awkward now because it's got its tripod fully extended, so. I'm taking it that timer has gone.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's turn the power off, see what happened.
How long was that? I forgot.
5 minutes.
Okay.
So, I can feel there's a curb there, but it's pretty minimal right now. So based off of experience, it's just been a while since I've done any steel. So I didn't want to do it too fast. I think we could probably go for another 10 minutes, and then that's going to be like it for it. So if we could get a 10-minute alarm set.
Done.
Thank you. Turn that back on. Okay, so now we got this piece. And I'm gonna just round the corners. I'm gonna just do a little quick bit of dressing on this.
Did you make that grinder, that belt sander?
No, I didn't, but I bought it off a guy who did, and he did a pretty good job. Everything is fairly dialed in. I've got a pretty aggressive belt on it right now. And so this one has got a lot less of an aggressive, my deburr. I'm just going to come over here to soften the edges.
What belts do you like? What supplier? Do you have a favorite?
Well,
Harbor Freight.
For this one, I just get the Harbor Freight. I think they're 36 by 6. And I haven't had to buy any belt for my 2x72 yet. It came with a whole mess of them. I was just looking the other day that I think I need to get some. I use a lot of the high grit belts on there. There's like a 36, kind of using a 36 or a 60 or an 80 usually.
Yeah.
And it only came with a few of those, but it sure came with a whole lot of like 200, 300, 400, 600. So
he must have been a knife maker, huh?
Oh yeah. He liked the knives. So for this one, you know, we're going to clean it, get the front off. We're going to do this with some fire. To do this, I'm going to open up my back door. I'm going to light the forge. I'm going to throw in a respirator and you're going to see why. I highly recommend, heat works really, really well for the initial clean on these things, but, do it in a ventilated spot and do not breathe this shit in. I think it is almost entirely the whiteout that works so well. But let me get this in a good spot and then open my door.
Yeah, they use that whiteout for canister welding as well. I'm not sure how. I guess it has zinc in it. Lots of zinc.
Yeah, I can see that. I mean, that's probably why it seems so god awful. It's bad.
Yeah. I know someone else who has one like that.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, Joe.
Yeah.
That old fire idea.
Let's get so I'm just gonna kind of hold on to this thing because it is copper. You know, I could let it sit in there. It doesn't need to get crazy, crazy hot. But you'll start to see, oh, there's our green flame. And it's just more and more green and green and green. And I'll usually flip it at some point. And once the green goes away, it's clean. I got no more green. So, forge off. We'll come back over here. So now it has been colored. All that's been burnt off. And so the next step for cleaning this is kind of like, what do you want your finish to be? Sometimes it doesn't really matter if the inside is dark or it's not. Are you looking to have these things bright and shiny? You know, I think this one could look pretty cool, like getting cleaned and just getting like a fire patina to it. It would make, you know, the anvil shape and all that way more natural, but we will just do a little bit of cleaning on it. So I got some 200 grit sandpaper here. And when I'm sanding, I'm purposely trying to go off of the piece on either side. So I'm not stopping in the middle to create like swirls. I'm trying to run it through. And you could use lower than 200 grit.
3 minutes to go on your soak.
Great, thank you. So if you were really trying to get this clean, clean, because you wanted to add a patina to it, or you were really wanting to just get down to base with the copper, I would throw this in a pickle. I use a citrus pickle that I got off Auto Fry. Takes a little longer, it sits in a crock pot. Because I still have a lot of copper oxides that are happening in here. They're going to be really, really hard to get to. But let's just say, you know, we want this black or blacker. And so this section in here that's in the anvil, it's kind of hard to get that dark and then buff off the outside. Because when you're running the sandpaper over it, it's lower, but it's not lower enough, unless you're using like a piece of glass, some really, really flat surface and taking a lot of care and time, it's going to want to sand the inside of that as well, which is why a lot of this oxide's gone, but not in the hammer handle or in these letters, because they're just deep enough and the gap's shallow enough that it's not really hitting it. I'm going to give this thing a dunk again, kind of clean it off, dry it off. I think we're coming in on our 10-minute mark.
1 minute left.
Okay. Well, we'll call 1 minute one and a half. So I've turned that off so I'm not electrocuting myself. Well, it's etching, but it's not etching nearly as fast as I thought that it would. My experience has shown me that steel etches really quickly, and this is not etching so quickly. So now I've got this like concern that actually this is not cold rolled steel and this is stainless steel. but it wouldn't be stainless. It wouldn't be picking up this oxidation, I don't think, unless it's like, it'd have to be a one of those magnetic stainlesses, and I don't think I have any stainless sheet. It's etching just slower than I thought it would. The first time that I did a piece of steel in one of these things, I was so used to running these like coppers and brasses, and it was taking 40 minutes, you know, to run a section. And I was usually checking it at the half hour mark and then kind of going from there on what it looked like. And I put my first piece of steel in there and I set it for a half an hour. Just in my head, it made sense that steel would take so much longer than copper. And I put it in a half an hour and I'd come back and it had burnt holes right through it. it was a pretty destroyed piece. So this copper one, because it's nice, fire can kind of reset all the woes. And so we're gonna throw a patina on here. See if we can't get the inside to get a little dark. I really like this stuff. This is super blue. It's a gun blue. I buy it at Bi-Mart. Not to be confused with regular blue, the super really makes a lot. It works great on steel for darkening steels. You got like a weld spot that you're trying to make the shine go away. It works great for that. And it definitely throws a patina on copper. So so I'm just going to put a little on there. And I'm going to rub the whole thing down. I'm trying to really get it into all the zones. And it's kind of like right before your eyes. Are you able to see that? Am I in the zone? So yeah, we just had this talk with Phil Baldwin. He was telling us about the Baldwin patina that only reacts to coppers, copper-based metals. And now I really want to get some to try just for this, because this thing is already so dark. It's so strange. I look at it on the phone and in real life, and it's much darker looking in real life. The phone's really picking up a lot more of the copper highlights than it is just looking at it. So I'll kind of clean that off. Pretty dark. And you know, let me grab a new piece of sandpaper and I'll get a hard backing on it. Lids back on things you're done using. Good practice. I'm just going to do this right on the table, upside down. Picking up the outsides. So, you know, I mean, you can just keep going after this stuff. One of the things that I like to do with these kind of plates, and I'll do it to this one, because I think I might play with the patina on this one a little more, is I will use a rounding hammer and kind of scallop the edges. I think that it's a really attractive look. So it just kind of barely brings it in there. If you got thicker metals, that really shows a lot more. We got some jazz going?
Yeah, I got to answer this. It's my hay cutting person.
Oh, why don't you take it? I got it for a minute, Kenny.
Okay. Hello.
Okay. Well, so here is kind of this one finished.
Yeah, Kellen, somebody's asking, folks are asking, how thick is the copper?
Copper is in this weird weight system. And so I just usually call my copper what its equivalent would be in steel. And so this is about 16 gauge. It's about a 16th of an inch thick. A lot of my copper that I run is about that size. I can't remember what the weight system is if you were to call and order it. I'm going to do a fire patina on this one just so you guys can see really after it's been cleaned what like a really good deep fire patina can look like. Hopefully I don't melt it in the process. I just realized that, I put that steel one back into the rectifier, right into the back of the solution, but then I didn't turn the rectifier on. So it's just been sitting there for a few minutes doing nothing. So we're maybe a little behind schedule on that one. But fire patinas are one of my very, very favorite things. I've made these things, I call them reliquaries. They're little copper and brass kind of forged balls, two plates meet each other. And I really, really got into fire patinas for them and learned a bunch of different kind of ways to go about it. And so I'm going to use at least one of those right now. Want to just note, I moved my slack tub directly in line with this because for coppers, when you go to quench it and the fire patina happens, if you are holding on to it with a set of tongs, this section where there's a heat differential around your hold, where you're holding, is going to show. It's going to be like everything else might be this beautiful color, and then right here it's this like different thing going on. And so I have really fallen into the habit of trying to take a very light, loose corner grip with getting it hot, and then it comes out and I just drop it into water. So when it hits the water, there's nothing in contact with it that's going to be changing that heat zone other than just the quench. But I've etched these things, you can put an etch on anything. This could be 1-inch thick plate and you could etch into it. You couldn't etch, it's always going to be about the same depth of an etch. So for this heat, what I'm going to do right now, because I'd really like to get it to get some kind of bright, dark colors, is I'm going to bring this thing as close to like a critical heat as I can get it before I think I'm going to melt it. And it's kind of dangerous, you're playing with fire. it's dangerous in the sense that materials like copper and brass, getting them into those really, really high temperatures, they'll be fine, and then all of a sudden they're melting. So actually, I'm going to do it this way. So I'm not even holding a corner. I've kind of got it resting on another piece. It's going to give me a lot more of an even heat. And I know the phone is not going to read this. That is like a dull orange. I want to get this thing to a pretty close to a bright orange. If you go much beyond that, you really could be melting material. I'm pretty close. And drop. And then you got to find it. Let's get over to the light. So I probably should have gone hotter. I chickened out. I didn't want to melt it in front of a group. I've got some like oranges, a little bit of purples. The back's got some cool purple and some kind of like salmon colors. You know, I wish I'd gotten it a little hotter. But now that it's got these kind of colors, at least on the back, I think I can do a light buff on the front. And I'll use Scotch-Brite pads sometimes. I think they work really well. I usually have the greens and the blues, but I just ran out. So I'm just down to the whites.
Now, Bryson's asking the million-dollar question, how do you preserve the colors? Clear coat, question mark?
Oh, well, that is the beauty of fire patina. If you need to preserve a copper or brass that you have cleaned and scrubbed and gotten most of that patina off and you're trying to get it to a natural color, then yes, you need to clear coat it with something. I've used like rattle can clear coats. I'm not a big fan of rattle cans, but I have had success with that. Depending on what your copper's final, you know, destination is going to be, beeswax is not a bad choice. I've used Johnson's paste wax before for copper. I think it looks a little streaky. But if it's just fire patina, the scale, not really scale when it's on copper, it's a patina. It's like just an oxidation. It is crazy hard and really durable. And so I will add a little bit of wax or a little bit of oil to kind of shine it up. But this side, if I do nothing to it right now, like that's going to start oxidizing and it's going to look like kind of oldish copper pretty soon. This side where I've left this fire patina alone, I can pretty much do nothing to this. And down here where it's a little less, that might start to patina. This side is going to stay very, very true to those colors, short of being like buffed or scratched. The fire oxidation that happens, especially with copper, is incredibly durable.
Have you done the fire patina with a torch as well, or?
Yeah, you can do it with a torch. It's definitely works, and I learned a lot of my fire patina stuff from COMAG member Missy Powell, who has since moved to Hawaii and we all miss her dearly, and she taught me so many tips and tricks, and she does almost all of her stuff with a torch. And so that was kind of how I first learned, was like controlling this with a torch and how to use heat and at what temperatures you're kind of quenching it in, and other additives you can add to really change the look of things. And then I just kind of went crazy with it and started doing all my own experiments and learning that, like, oh, you can really, a fire patina in coming out of a forge at a really, really high temperature into cold water gives you a lot different look than that same temperature into hot water. So I definitely got a curb here. I can feel it. It's there. Like I said, I'm a little surprised this has not been etching as aggressively, but it has etched. I think I'm going to clean this off. I'm going to pull this other piece. I'm going to pull my cathode out of here because it's all covered in rust. right? And so it was getting plated. You can see it. This is that like gunk. It's just like, but it's not plating to it. You know, I can just wipe it right off versus the copper, where it's like, you know, I can wipe some of this stuff that's like the crystal oxidation off, but it's like the copper look that's in the middle of that, like that is plated to this brass. You can see up in the corner here, there's little bits of brass that are still peeking through, but then they're covered in copper. And then all this green is just like a natural copper and brass oxidation from this thing having lived so much of its time in salt water, and then coming out, not really getting like clean very thoroughly and just like set out to dry. So, you know, I would put all this out there that it's like, this has been my learning process and experience with etching. It was something I got into about 7 or 8 years ago. I took a class at our community college and met Jim Daling, who was the teacher at the time. And he really had kind of mentioned this process, and I was just like infatuated with it right away. There's another COMAG member, Denise Harrison, who's got some really cool products. She does a lot of etching, and we were kind of learning all this at the same time in the beginning. And one of the things that I have learned is that there's a lot of different ways to do this. You know, the same process could happen without without a rectifier, no electricity. It can just be acid. I just think it's dirty, a little toxic. But then you could also move on to like this resist that I'm using, I think is really good for what I want. I really like the way that, especially out of my copy machine, that's a little dirty and it kind of doesn't like fail in spots, but it creates this antique look because so much of what I make kind of looks old right out of the gate. And so, I think that's a really good way to go about it, but there are other ways to do this resist. And I can't remember the name of the machine. Maybe somebody in the audience knows, but you can get these like vinyl sticker printer cutter things where you get these sheets of like sticky back vinyl and you can put the same image into it and it will cut that shape out. And then you have this vinyl sticker that you slap on the metal and really push it down and it holds and it's not gonna fail like it in the same way that this will. I think doing little tiny marks and like the dots inside of the B aren't really gonna be something that could happen with that vinyl machine. But if you were just looking for like the shape of an anvil, and you really wanted the field around it to stay super, super clean and not have any like marks that happened, those kind of stickers could be really good. Or, you know, if you had a logo that was simple enough that it didn't have floating parts, that would be a lot easier to do if you were doing like an acid etch on knives or something.
Cricut, someone mentioned Cricut would be the...
Yeah, that sounds familiar. Yeah, one of my friends got one a while ago and she quite liked it and was trying to get me to sign up and have her make stickers for it. But, you know, I'm resistant to change sometimes. I have my way of doing things. Okay, so we're gonna whittle this thing away and just start by like getting it closer to a circle shape. Thank you. All right. So we got like a rough circle, real rough. And so I used to, as soon as these things would come out of the rectifier, I would start, I would just clean them. I'd get them right in the fire. So now we got around. We're just gonna do that same process we did with the last one, just to burn all this off. And then we're kind of coming in on the tail end of this, because there's, I'm gonna show kind of the, what I would call the dirty trick for making the text on this be dark. With this one being steel, I feel a little less like I don't need to babysit it. It's not going to melt away in there. So, no, I don't have a whole lot to do with this one. I'm going to let the color run out of it. It's being steel. I just don't want to quench it. In case I was going to be putting a hole in it or something. I mean, it is just mild or even cold rolled. Really wouldn't affect hardness that much. But I do like letting the color run out of things. Right.
And Larry Reed said,
all right, so with the steel one, we're gonna come over here. We're gonna flip down. Nope, I'm unplugged. Okay, so we got, right, NWBA, real shiny coin. Now, since this one, it did not etch as deeply, this would be a little harder to like throw on a patina and then recover that patina and then buff it out and have it so that the low spot stayed low. So, this is kind of the quick and cheap and dirty trick, is a nice Sharpie will accomplish that exact same goal. And I have found that if you fill in all the low spots, and try to be a little careful that you're not just getting it everywhere, but it doesn't really matter because you're going to buff it back off. This works really well if the font is really small and you're trying to get in and just brighten up or darken up some lines. Might be a little big for this little anvil. But I've used shoe polish. I've tried to use paints and enamels and buffing them out. And I might end up burning this out before I send it to you, Lynn. We'll see what it looks like when it's done. I found, you know, the Sharpie trick kind of works a little better on the brasses and the bronzes and the coppers than it does on the steel. And with this thing being so wide there, you get like brush marks essentially. I mean, you know, from a distance, pretty good. I'll throw some paste wax on there right now, just to see if it kind of mutes out the Sharpie background.
Have you ever hand wire brushed it?
Yeah, but the wire brush just gets into those gaps. It's not gonna make your text any darker. It's gonna just clear them out. Oh yeah, see, it's just moving. It pulled it all out of there. Kind of left it in some of the corners. Works better on copper. But it did leave it in the corners a little bit, right? And so it's like, kind of shows the profile. Before I call this quits here, I would add that, you know, with a plate like these ones, I really put thought into what the border was going to look like, and then knowing that I had rivets. And so I actually marked those rivet holes out in the etch and had dots that were exactly there. So when my plate got done, one, I had exterior lines, so I knew where I could cut to. And then I had the dots for the rivets already etched in there. So the drilling was really, really simple. And then I added a decorative border to this one. And so this one, I got a pretty nice dark font. I used that super blue. I hit the whole thing, so the whole thing was dark, and then I buffed off the high spots. But I think that's about the whole show. Any last questions? Well, cool, everyone. Well, thanks for coming. If there's no more questions, I'm going to call this meeting over. Thanks for coming and attending. And Lynn, we'll get these things shipped out to you. I think I got your address. So,
thanks, Kellen. It was a blast. I appreciate it.
Oh, thank you. Really appreciate you hosting, Kenny.